In Sauvé, the head of knowledge translation at the Michael Smith Genome Science Center. He is responsible for managing the development and delivery of strategies and materials to disseminate research into the scientific community and beyond. He has more than a decade of experience as a science communicator and is familiar with healthcare policy through work with the Provincial Health Service Authority. There's really no better person to help us settle the difference between KT and communication. Welcome, Kevin.
Thank you very much, Ellen. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Feel free to share.
There we go. How's that? Can you see my presentation?
Yep.
Excellent. All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for your interest today, for taking the time to join me. Of course, thank you to Michael Smith Health Research BC for this excellent opportunity to share my knowledge and experience with you all. I also want to acknowledge my employer, Canada's Michael Smith Genome Sciences Centre, for providing the flexibility to engage in these excellent opportunities and to really have the courage to cultivate a KT practice in and fundamental science discipline. I've also listed my contact information on the screen. Please feel free to send me an email. You can find me on Twitter and also connect with me on LinkedIn. Happy to take questions via those channels after this presentation as well. But first, I'd like to begin by acknowledging the people on whose land I'm speaking from today, on whose and who I've shown on my the land I've shown on my virtual background here as well, the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh peoples. I'm not from here. I grew up in a small town, the youngest in a family of four. My parents were from French, German, and Scottish heritage, outside of a place called Kitchener, which is the ancestral land of the Haudenosaunee people and the Anishinaabe peoples. I came to this region to attend the University of British Columbia in 2008. It's where I met my wife, and now we're settled here to raise our two beautiful children. This photograph here is a photograph I took of a place that we enjoyed very much, what many know as Mount Garibaldi, but what the Squamish people call Nechka. You wouldn't know it from this photograph, but I recently learned that Nechka means the grimy one in reference to the muddy water from the nearby Chikai River. In Squamish mythology, Nechka was the peak to which people tied their canoes to avoid being swept away in the Great Flood. So what are we doing here today? Today, I'm going to tell you about the difference between science communications and knowledge translation. Because KT activities necessarily involve communication and dissemination of findings from scientific research, in particular health research often, there's considerable overlap between the two disciplines. This has led to confusion, in some cases even tension, particularly within institutions that participate in both activities. So our first learning objective is to define these things, particularly in relation to health research, which is the context that I find myself within today. It is important to note that although the well-recognized definition of KT often refers to health, it is also widely applicable to other sectors, which I found through my work in climate science. I'll touch on that briefly, but not extensively. Then we'll elaborate on the similarities and differences of communications and knowledge translation in theory, but also practice. And we'll finally explore some simple skills, strategies, and approaches to take when planning to do either or both. So let's start with a poll first. Can we launch the poll? Do you consider yourself to practice a form of science communication? And also, do you consider yourself to practice a form of knowledge translation? Let's just get a sense of the audience here. Any numbers coming in? Lots of science communicators so far. Okay. Getting closer here. Interesting. Not a lot of people can't help talking and tweeting about every publication that they read. Okay, getting pretty close to everyone. about 80%. Okay. Looks like we've ended the poll. Can we see the results? Okay, so it looks like the majority of people, a lot of people here, about 31%, communicate science for as their work, as their career, or they regularly present and educate with some form of general audience about of some form of science communication. So about 2/3 of people quite familiar with science communication. And we've got about half of the people that aren't researchers, but are employed and affiliated with an institution to support knowledge translation. Excellent. So there are those that are new to the field. And so this will be a crash course for you guys and maybe some redundancy for those that know this well, but I think you'll all get something out of it. Okay. So before I begin, here's a picture of me performing both of my full-time duties as a KT practitioner and father of two, actually, the latter being the thing that motivates me to do the former. This was taken at an exciting knowledge translation event at the GSC for its 20th anniversary in November 2019, 2 weeks after the birth of my daughter, Nova. I'm currently the head of KT at the GSC, and my work involves the synthesis, dissemination, and exchange of research and knowledge on behalf of 16 faculty members, labs, technology platform leaders, and as well as our clinical services operations. I love my job. It combines my passion for biology, interest in biotechnology and skills in communication with my desire in some small way to contribute to making people's lives better, especially for those with cancer. Prior to my work with the GSC, I worked as a communications officer with the Provincial Health Services Authority stationed at BC Cancer, which really helped me to better understand healthcare, research, and policy. Prior to that, I worked with several nonprofit organizations in health and environmental communications, devising strategies to engage the public and decision makers to advance evidence-based policy, particularly in climate policy. As an undergraduate student, I studied molecular biology and neuroscience and had fully intended to spend my life in academia until I realized that I had a proclivity for writing and speaking about science and a sense that perhaps maybe we know enough already, especially about some of our biggest and most pressing issues. So I turned my sights to science communication, traveling to the University of British Columbia to study science journalism. I worked for a while with the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation and as a freelance writer. And then, as I mentioned, as a communications consultant. Now, here I am in KT. And thanks to COVID, this is about as exciting as it gets for me now, just like many of you. Mind you, training a future knowledge broker can be a lot of fun. So here's a picture of a man whom I've never met, but who nonetheless has had a significant impact on my life and career, Dr. Carl Sagan. In my perspective, Dr. Sagan was a master science communicator, intelligent and articulate, yet engaging and relatable, curious and passionate, yet skeptical and reasonable. He is the author of more than 600 scientific papers and articles and the co-author or editor of more than 20 books about science, from cosmology to biology, from science fiction to critical thinking. He spent most of his career as a professor of astronomy at Cornell University, where he directed the Laboratory for Planetary Studies. Yet he was a tireless advocate for skeptical scientific inquiry and a prolific science communicator. He is perhaps best known for the award-winning 1980 television series that he co-wrote and narrated, Cosmos, A Personal Voyage, which became one of the first and most widely watched science series in the history of American public television. It won an Emmy and a Peabody Award and transformed Sagan from an obscure astronomer into a pop culture icon. I was a young boy of about 10 years, I think, when I first saw his series of 13 episodes that covered the range of scientific subjects, including the origin of life on Earth and our human place on it. But his narrative-driven stories of science instilled in me a passion for the discipline and for biology in particular, as well as a deep desire to tell everyone about it. I remember sitting at the kitchen table reciting lines to my mother in my best Sagan-esque voice, deep, slow, monotone. "We are but stardust harvesting sunlight," to which she'd smile and graciously indulge me, even if she had no idea what I was talking about. But he also impressed upon me deep concern for the future of our species. A quote from one of his last books in 1995, The Demon-Haunted World, "Science as a Candle in the Dark," has stayed with me as a chilling prognosis of the situation that we find ourselves in today. We have arranged a civilization in which most crucial elements are profoundly dependent on science and technology. We have also arranged things so that almost no one understands science and technology. Sooner or later, this combustible mixture of ignorance and power is going to blow up in our faces. 10 years before he published that quote in 1985, Dr. Sagan testified to the US Congress that the greenhouse effect would dramatically change the Earth's climate system with devastating effects for humanity. Nearly four decades later, despite the mountain of scientific evidence confirming his testimony, we still find ourselves endlessly debating the merits and credibility of scientists and their methodology, fretting over the words like probability and uncertainty, and justifying political and economic stagnation in the absence of anything short of directly observed global catastrophe. These numbers speak for themselves. Today, there is a 99% scientific consensus that we're warming the planet, but only a fraction of us say that we believe that the evidence is conclusive, or that industrial activity is indeed the cause. The science has been communicated ad nauseum, but we still have our doubts, and we most certainly have not done enough politically or economically to make the carbon emission cuts that science indicates that we must to avoid the worst of the crisis. From my years of experience in devising communication strategies to communicate climate science to the public and policymakers, I believe this lack of action speaks to the need for something more than straightforward dissemination of evidence to the masses and those that are in power to make the decisions. It speaks to deeply held beliefs, differing worldviews, trust, values, power, culture, and language. But let's bring things back to the realm of health research. Nowhere and at no time do I believe that we have better evidence of the problem with a history of poorly communicated science than in our current crisis, the COVID-19 pandemic and the associated infodemic. What we're seeing now is not only clear evidence that we have not done enough to help people to better understand the science of microbiology and immunological technologies, such as vaccines, but also that misinformation and disinformation can spread so rapidly that we might struggle to catch up with it. And this has clear and frightening implications for public health. We're now living in a world where pretty much anyone can say anything at any time, broadcast it to almost everyone, anywhere, instantaneously, regardless of their credibility, understanding, or objectivity. If they tap into the right emotional cord, they may gain an audience of millions. Science communication is hard because it requires not only accuracy, honesty, and an ability to comprehend complexity and make that understandable, but because it also often requires relaying hard truths to many people that they might not want to hear, let alone engage with. But if you're not worried about telling the truth or about gathering evidence, or maybe you're even being motivated to distort it for personal gain, then with just a little whiff of understanding of the current cultural climate, communications is easy. In other words, scientific misinformation spreads easily because it is not subject to the constraints of the scientific method. So what are we going to do about it? In the spring of April 2020, Canada Research Chair in Health Law and Policy at the University of Alberta, Timothy Caulfield, published an opinion article in the Nature Worldview on this very issue. I saw it because of this bright orange banner that appeared on my Twitter feed that read, "It is inappropriate for scientists to let misinformation go unremarked." Of course, I clicked it. The article, "Pseudoscience and COVID-19, We've Had Enough Already," discussed the overwhelming volume of content on social media that was inaccurate or misleading and not supported by any evidence about COVID-19, its origins, public health measures to deal with it, et cetera, including from prominent politicians and other public figures. In it, Caulfield provides a description for dealing with pseudoscience and the infodemic, first and foremost, by disallowing non-evidence-based treatments to be used or embraced by health centers, universities, or hospitals, but secondly, by encouraging and in some cases providing incentives for more researchers to become active participants in the fight against misinformation. Quote, "We need physicists, microbiologists, immunologists, gastroenterologists, and all scientists from relevant disciplines to provide simple and shareable content explaining why this hijacking of real research is inaccurate and scientifically dishonest." Disinformation expert Claire Wardle at Harvard University in Cambridge, Massachusetts, has said, "The best way to fight misinformation is to swamp the landscape with accurate information that is easy to digest, engaging, and easy to share on mobile devices." So let's get swamping. question for you all. What are some of the reasons that might prevent scientists from freely or regularly communicating their research about their expertise? Feel free to pop it in the chat. Time, absolutely. Privacy, lack of time and resources. Ethics, worries about getting scooped, harassment, legal risk, backlash and trolls, skills for writing for the public. It's not easy to communicate and amplify. Possibility of getting shadow banned. Requirements for publication. Scientists are not making decisions in health agencies about what they are allowed to share. Very good. This is exactly what I want to touch on. Personal risk to family. Yes, it's a dangerous world on social media. There we go. So yes, thank you everybody. Just one sec. Professional opinion isn't sufficient in a media world. Okay. So with few exceptions, many scientists and researchers desperately want to communicate their knowledge. They rightfully have immense passion in their endeavors and pride in their accomplishments. They also feel a strong moral and ethical duty to do so. But again, with few exceptions, they have historically lacked the time, skills, confidence, means, or support to engage outside of traditional academic arenas, such as peer-reviewed publishing or presenting at conferences, so-called internal science communication. Kimberly Collins et al., writing for PLOS One in 2016, explained reasons why some scientists were hesitant to join Twitter, for example. Some scientists were hesitant to use social media outlets because of due to a lack of knowledge of the platform, inexperience with how it could make meaningful, how they could make meaningful posts. Some scientists didn't see it as valuable or understand its function, as well as time, energy, and resources to do it well. But they're also not operating in isolation, as this graphic shows, and as someone mentioned in the chat. So research funders have their own communications interests, policies, procedures for grant-funded research, as do the institutions that researchers are embedded within, which more often than not have their own communications and public affairs departments. These institutional communications activities are often referred to as strategic communications. So as you can see on this graphic here, I've illustrated from an adapted illustration from someone else, the internal communications take place among scientists, and there are joining factors to other sectors of society, but I've emphasized this dark black line between institutionally linked communication to emphasize the point that their communications are very much influenced by the institutions and the funding sources that they receive as well, in many cases, not all cases. So I'll touch on strategic communications in a second, but first I want to just present one accepted definition of science communication. So there, in their review of the literature on science communication and its differences, Burns et al. In 2003 developed one of the more influential definitions to date. The use of appropriate skills, media activities, and dialogue to produce one or more of the following personal responses to science: awareness, enjoyment, interest, opinion forming, and understanding. There are also two types of science communication that could include inward facing, so expert to expert communication from similar different scientific backgrounds, also called in reach, such as via conference presentations or publications in scientific journals, as well as outward facing, so direct or indirect communication by science professionals to non-expert audiences, such as via science journalism, social media, science museums, etc. So it is true that science outreach may generate support for scientific research or science education and inform decision-making, including political and ethical thinking. And it can also be an effective mediator between the different groups and individuals that have a stake in public policy, industry, and civil society. However, I think you'll see knowledge translation has a much better framework for this kind of activity. Again, more on that in a minute. So as mentioned, with few exceptions, science communicators rarely operate in isolation, but within science institutions and are influenced by the communications goals of those institutions as well as by agencies that fund. Within organizations that have a vested interest in research, to do it, to use it, to share it, communications can be about the type of research being conducted, noteworthy research awards, significant findings from research that might inform a broad audience in meaningful ways. And this is really the domain of strategic or corporate communications, which can be defined as the efforts made to inform, influence, or persuade target audience or audiences in support of identified goals. So it is ultimately a corporate function that disseminates and reinforces messages in support of an organization's strategic plan. To be strategic means to communicate the best message through the right channels and to measure against organizational and communication specific goals. Communication is strategic in this sense when it is completely aligned with a corporation's mission, vision, and values, and it's able to enhance that strategic positioning and competitiveness of the organization. Strategic communications is typically the purview of communication or public affairs departments working in concert with other departments, such as marketing, to develop the communication strategy that best reflects the overall organizational plan. So this is to highlight and illustrate many scientists seek to do science communication, but they're doing so within the context of many other interests and stakeholders, sometimes aligned and not always. So here's an approach to planning communications. This is one framework, whether it be scientific communications or strategic, and I choose this one because it's most adaptable in all contexts and easy to remember. I won't go into the details heavily, but here's the gist. COMS stands for context, outcomes, messages, methods, supports, stakeholders. These are five categories of variables that, if well thought through, will always improve communication planning. Each can effectively be seen as a bucket of questions that you should generate and answer in order, in this order, prior to execution. A problem with many communication plans or proposals is that they lead with methods. You publish a paper and you want to put out a press release, or you want to approach it on Twitter. This is hardly strategic until we understand the context, what we're hoping people will do with that message, distilling the message and making it accessible to the particular audience, and then knowing who's going to support us along the way to sustain that message and to have it taken up in the audience that we want it taken up within. So it's also scalable, this comms approach. So from having a conversation to delivering a presentation to developing a communications plan or an organizational strategy. Often communications is a time-dependent discipline. If you're lucky, you can have a nice, long, lazy, sprawling strategy session, but more often than not, time is of the essence. So comms is easy to remember. So if we take a quick look at these, I could spend a whole day up talking about each one of them, but just to touch on what they are so you have a sense of why they're important. So in context, you know, what is new and how does it relate to the bigger picture? How does this fit within our vision, mission, and values? Outcomes, why communicate at all? Should we communicate? What are you trying to achieve? Messages, what's the single most important thing? The supporting messages, two or three at most. Bottom line, actionable message, what do you want people to do with this information? Methods, are you going to go to the mainstream media? You're going to write a press release? You're going to drum up some support from journalists that you know? Are you going to write, and this is often referred to as earned content, or are you going to put something on the web? You're going to write a blog, share it on social media, etc. This is owned content. Advertising, brochures, etc., paid content, as well as formal and informal meetings and presentations. Stakeholders, who do you need to work with to make this happen? Internal and external stakeholders and partnerships as well. And what's your budget? There are two other things that need to be kept in mind throughout this whole process though. Audience first. Who are we talking to and what are their information needs? What do we want them to do with it? What's the best way to reach them? Who can help us reach them? You need to think in terms of your primary audience, the people that you really want to know this information and perhaps to do something with it. But who are other people that need to be informed? Secondary, tertiary contacts. What about measurement? How are we going to know what's working if we don't measure it? So what has been successful before in the current context? How will we know we are successful this time? Which messages worked, did not? What methods worked, which did not? How effective were our supports? How happy were our stakeholders? What's the return on investment? Okay, one more poll for you guys. Does the institution organization that you work within employ communications professionals, knowledge translation professionals, both or neither? Please launch the poll. in the meantime, it's a good question I'm seeing here. It says, in my opinion, I think we as scientists need to be careful with what we put out to the public. A small study may not be generalizable. Of the certainty of evidence may be low or very low. And so presenting low certainty evidence to the public, I think, may be careless on our part. Absolutely. And that's why it's important to think through strategy, think through the context, think through all of these various objectives and components of a communication plan before you decide whether to communicate, how to communicate, what you're going to say about it, and even if you should communicate at all. Rather than just jumping on Twitter and posting your paper or your pre-publication, it's wise to think through the variables within a communication plan. So we have the majority of people here have both KT and ScienceCom professionals in their institutions, or at least public affairs offices and strategic communications. That's really interesting. A close second is communication professionals. So at 28%, so about a third is only communication professionals. Okay, that's really interesting. Thanks, guys. I think this also helps us to illustrate the growing nature of KT and its value in society and in scientific institutions. So let's turn our attention now to knowledge translation. This will be a crash course for those new to the field, like I said, and simple stuff to those that practice it already. Researchers are increasingly being asked by funding organizations such as CHR and MSHRBC to include dissemination or implementation plans within grant proposals, as they rightfully are seeking greater societal impacts of their research and support. For example, a series of articles by Chalmers and Glasseau, which a lot of people are familiar with in the KT space and the Lancet in 2009, highlighted an analysis of avoidable wasted research, what they called the leaky research pipeline. Through inefficiencies ranging from the relevance of research questions for patients and clinicians to biased reporting or lack of publishing at all, these researchers illustrated how a lot of research being produced worldwide is not being used in practice or policy, amounting to potentially tens of billions of dollars of investment in research being lost every year due to correctable problems. What has emerged is a rapidly growing interest in finding new practices that support the flow of discoveries, ideas, and innovations out of the lab and from peer-reviewed papers to better enable their overarching social, economic, technological, and health benefit aims. These practices have a variety of names, often used synonymously: knowledge transfer, knowledge mobilization, knowledge exchange, implementation, translational research, and of course, knowledge translation, as well as others. Of all these terms, it seems that KT has gained the most prominence in Canada so far, and it's the one I'm using today, obviously. So it may be surprising to learn, or perhaps not given what we know about the leaky research pipeline, that research shows that left on its own devices, it takes about 17 years to translate evidence from publication to practice or policy. Knowledge translation seeks to accelerate these timelines and optimize the use of evidence in practice and policy. KT seeks to capture the movement of research evidence along a continuum of several translational moments. So from basic human research, from human clinical research to clinical practice, and from clinical settings to implementation or practice change in community policy, global health settings, et cetera. Some research suggests that effective KT planning to reduce the time it takes for evidence to change practice and policy has many spin-off benefits from further research to advanced commercialization and enhanced public understanding of science, and can move this timeline down to just 3 years. This is a BioRender figure I made of a cheesy knowledge translation catalyst. I hope you all enjoy it. CIHR provides one of the more popular definitions among several for knowledge translation that has also been adopted by the World Health Organization. It calls it a dynamic and iterative process that includes synthesis, dissemination, exchange, and ethically sound application of knowledge to improve health, provide more effective health services and products, and strengthen the healthcare system. Further, KT processes take place within a complex system of interactions between researchers and knowledge users, which may vary in the level of intensity, complexity, engagement, depending on the nature of the research and the findings, as well as the needs of particular knowledge users. Because KTs necessarily involve dissemination and communication of research findings, there is considerable overlap within the disciplines of strategic and science communications, which has led to confusion and, as mentioned, in some cases, tensions within institutions that encapsulate both functions. So this is one framework used by CHR to illustrate the process used in the creation, synthesis, dissemination, exchange, et cetera, of knowledge. What's important to illustrate here is that KT relies on synthesizing and tailoring knowledge before engagement with stakeholders, and that there are several generations of knowledge in that process. It's also important to note that singular studies are rarely the foundation for KT. Instead, systematic reviews and meta-analyses form the backbone that is then tailored to further reach specific targeted knowledge users. These are the functions in the center of this knowledge to action framework. The wheel on the outside are the other activities, tools, strategies, and approaches used to ensure that knowledge is taken up and then sustained by knowledge users. Another aspect of KT that makes it significantly different from communications is the level of engagement with partners and knowledge users. Again, note that knowledge users are more commonly referred to as audiences in communications. So there's a spectrum of engagement and what's known as integrated KT, where the knowledge user may become a fundamental part of research, synthesis, exchange, and even application and sustainability of knowledge use. The theory here is that involving knowledge users as equal partners alongside researchers will lead to research that is more relevant and useful to the knowledge users, and that uptake and sustainability of it will be increased through involved and continued engagement. So I'm not gonna go into vast detail. We don't have enough time for that, unfortunately, but this is a great example of a knowledge translation template developed by Barwick and the KT team from the Hospital for Sick Children. I know many KT practitioners are very familiar with it. But for those that aren't, this is an excellent KT resource, and they have others on their website, including how to write plain language summaries or develop detailed implementation plans. As you can see in this case, KT planning can be much more broad and involved and therefore take much more time, energy, resources than communications planning. It begins with looking at project partners and who could benefit from this research, the level of engagement that you want from them, and the roles that they play. Knowing what KT expertise you need, and there is not just one KT expert, there are many people that contribute to this field, and especially when it's done successfully. So that's also important. Here are the other variables on the template. So knowledge users, who benefits from this evidence? What are your main messages? Very similar to communications in that capacity. There's do a whole webinar on how to develop good messages. KT goals for each knowledge user, including awareness and decision aid making, how to inform research, facilitate policy change, et cetera. KT strategies. So these are dependent obviously on your goals. So the role-based, they could be educational, technological, they could be arts-based. And we've experimented with some of that at the Genome Sciences Center with a colleague of mine by the name of Martin Krasvinsky, who is a data scientist and a visualization artist. That's been quite enjoyable. Commercialization, technology transfer. There's also a KT process. So when will KT occur? Is it integrated or is it at the end of the grant? KT evaluation. So how do you know your goals have been achieved? And what are the resources, governing board, financial management, web, communication support, budget and procedures. So a lot goes into planning an effective KT strategy. So what are the take-home messages here? So what are the differences between knowledge translation versus communications? So both share content that is developed from, they develop content from knowledge from research. Whereas KT, which is the blue circle and communications being the red one, is primarily focused on synthesized research evidence. Communications often focuses on single studies and it's influenced by strategic internally developed messages such as vision, mission, and values. They both have pre-identified audiences. One refers to them as knowledge users and the other puts emphasis on stakeholders. Partners are engaged across the spectrum in KT. It's variable and it's encouraged throughout. They can be involved in the planning of research, the implementation of it, or the evaluation of that implementation and KT strategies. In communication, stakeholders are usually engaged early for support and message development. In some cases, they're more involved, but more often is the case that a press release would be shared with various stakeholders before it's launched, and that engagement might end shortly after. The process includes dissemination for both of them, but it also includes exchange of information between knowledge users and researchers, the application of that knowledge and its sustainable use. However, dissemination can often be the primary process and purpose of a communication strategy. They both strive for impact, whereas knowledge translation, impact is evaluated based on further research, services, policy changes, improved health, etc. In communications planning, it's usually evaluated on the share of voice received within the media or on social media, brand recognition, competitiveness, return on investment, etc. So before I turn to some specific work that I'm doing at the Genome Sciences Center in the last few minutes here, I was going to ask for questions, but I'm just taking a look at the time, so perhaps I'll just continue. Okay. So here's where I work. Many of you might know or be familiar with the BC Cancer Research Institute, or formerly known as the BC Cancer Research Center on the left. That's found on 10th Avenue and Heather Street in Vancouver. The one on the right is the Echelon Innovation Center, where we find our technology platform, which houses our DNA sequencers and a number of pieces of technology, including a large computational infrastructure, some of the largest in Canada for analyzing, storing genomic data. So what are the goals of the GSC? So they're to excel in the application of genomics, proteomics, and bioinformatics technologies to study problems related to health and disease, and in particular cancer, to create opportunities for clinical applications of genomics and translational cancer research, and to share access to research methods and infrastructure in collaboration with Canadian and other international experts. This is our core pipelines. So we have a biospecimen core where biological samples are received. They're processed in library core where adapters and other pieces of molecular technology are added to strands of DNA so that we can follow them throughout the pipeline and identify them as need be. Sequencing, so we have a high throughput, large scale sequencing platform that one of the largest in Canada, allows us to sequence about 12,000 human genomes at 30 times every year. Our bioinformatics core operates a number of high processing GPU units that is designated specifically for the analysis of genomic data. And we have a proteomics suite that analyzes the composition of tissues, the protein composition of tissues in very strategic ways and sophisticated ways. Throughout the process, we have, you know, a IT system, we have quality assurance, we have management administration, and KT falls within that. And then methods, tools, and instrument development. So technology development is also a core aspect of the GSC's research. Personalized oncogenomics. So there's many things. There's 16 faculty members at the Genome Sciences Center. But one of the core, and they have varying projects associated with cancer research, health and disease, and life science. One of the flagship programs that we're better known for is probably personalized oncogenomics. Personalized oncogenomics is a research program designed to identify mutations inherent in cancer genomes from across patients. We compare cancer genomes to normal tissue DNA to look at aberrations and mutations and find things that might not otherwise be found if we were doing something like targeted sequencing where you're looking for specific mutations. In this case, you're looking at the entire genome. The process here is that we consent and perform baseline for patients. So we receive them into the study. A biopsy is taken and sent to the Genome Sciences Center where we perform whole genome and transcriptome analysis. That information is de-identified and is shared in some cases globally. There is a new initiative called the Marathon of Hope Cancer Centers Network that is now in operation, funded by the Canadian government. And its intention is to share that data across the country between institutions the more data that we have access to and can compare to, the more powerful this type of research is. Once it's sequenced, it goes to a tumor board and back to the oncologist, where they discuss the findings and decide whether or not to change or keep a program of treatment the same or to change it. And a spinoff of that is that in some cases we find hereditary mutations within DNA, which could inform a cancer diagnosis for a family member. And then in that case, we would also reach out through our genetic counseling services that BC Cancer offers. Then there's could be clinical action, treatment, patient monitoring, further research, and the process continues again. The point of showing you this is that all along this pathway, there are opportunities for knowledge translation. So from consent and baseline, patients really need to understand what they're getting themselves into. So communicating to patients in an accessible way that allows them to understand what genome science is and what we're doing in cancer research, and to ensure that they're informed properly. At biopsy, very similar, there might be the patient needs to understand why they're receiving a biopsy, or the clinician or surgeon would want to know what it's being used for. Here, when we're doing data sharing initiatives, there's many people involved in this process that could better be educated or understand how it works. Tumor board meetings, there's a variety of professionals from pathologists to oncologists to clinicians that need to interpret this information and might not have otherwise seen something like a tumor report before. Similar to patients being consented in a hereditary cancer context, people need accessible plain language materials that can help them understand what this program is actually about. So my final notes here, just as an example of how effective KT or end science communications can be, and again, this is a correlation, this is not causation, we don't know this for sure, but if you look at this graph here, these are the number of POG biopsies we've received since about 2012 to 2020. And at specific points, you can see peaks in this, in when we've received the most biopsies. At this point in 2015, there was media attention to a patient and publicly recognized within the media. So I don't worry about sharing her name. It's Trish Keating. She was on CTV News and shared her story about having colorectal cancer that was treated. She went through the POG program and her treatment regime was changed to a blood pressure medication, and her cancer went into remission, and this became a very well-known story. At this point, the former BC Premier, Christy Clark, pledged her support for the POG program, offering it a million or so in support from the provincial government. And again, lots of media attention and a spike in biopsies. CBC did a documentary, which I highly recommend, called Cracking Cancer, and it was narrated by David Suzuki on the nature of things. And again, post publication of that documentary, we've seen a spike in biopsies. We've seen a decline recently, but with hope, we have a new knowledge translation approach. Here, with gracious funding from MSHRBC for a new animated video designed not necessarily to solicit any donations or anything of that nature, but as an education piece for patients, for family members, and the general public about what we're actually trying to achieve. Animation has been proven and shown in many cases to be an effective form of communication and knowledge translation. And we're very close to publishing this. This is a snapshot of our storyboard. And I look forward to sharing with it with you all when that's ready for publication. So last, I'll end with my science communication hero here, Dr. Carl Sagan. So there are naive questions, tedious questions, ill-phrased questions, questions put after inadequate self-criticism, but every question is a cry to understand the world. There's no such thing as a dumb question. So with that, I turn to you for your questions. Thank you very much for your time, your attention, and your engagement.
Thank you so much, Kevin, for such a knowledgeable presentation with some of the most powerful visuals I've seen. So we thank you for that. And to everyone who's still online, we're going to go just a few minutes over into our Q&A period. If you do have to go, please remember that the session is recorded. So with that, I will open up the floor to any questions. I do have one right off the top Kevin, this came in a little bit earlier, but would you recommend that science researchers team up with professional writers? And I know you've alluded to this earlier.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think, I mean, my own personal experience, I work closely with scientists at the Genome Sciences Center. My background is in science writing. That's probably what I enjoy doing most. And I would say in many cases, we've dramatically improved some of the communications coming from publications, or we've helped. And in fact, my team, so I head the knowledge translation team, and we have a professional science and technical writer on the team, as well as a knowledge translation coordinator. And the science and technical writer facilitates or supports writing and editing of manuscripts, of grants, of presentations, of proposals, and she is incredibly busy. So I would strongly suggest that scientists team up with professional writers, yes.
Awesome. And then a follow-up question to that is, it can be really challenging to have these kind of two teams to collaborate and to organize them. And what advice would you give to help break down these silos between, you know, the KT and the communications teams?
Yeah, I think communication is key. So even between these particular disciplines, I think when something is new, there are of course challenges, and I think KT is not new per se, but it is definitely burgeoning. It's becoming more of a discipline, and it is overlapping with traditional functions of communications departments. But I think things like this, where we help to define and clearly delineate what functions are within which departments and at which points collaboration, communication should happen, is probably to be most effective. And so I would think, yeah, people should spend time communicating, discussing, developing terms of references, project charters, making clear indications about where KT is, where communications is, and where collaboration really should happen for the most effective results for everyone.
Thank you so much, Kevin. We really, really appreciate it. With that, I'm going to thank Kevin for his time, and I'm going to conclude the Q&A period. And before everyone goes, I do want to kindly remind everyone that your feedback is extremely important to our team. And if you have a moment to please fill out the questionnaire that you will get in your email. And for the trainees who've signed up for the separate session, please join the separate Zoom link, and we'll see you there in about 5 minutes. And for more information about knowledge translation, to explore some of these supplemental resources, to share a recording of this awesome video, this session with Kevin, please visit the Michael Smith Health Research BC website shown on screen. And remember to join us on February 25th as we listen to Dr. Lise Olson share her take on promoting inclusive KT physical activity practices for children and youth with diverse abilities. And that concludes our session for today. For everyone online, thank you again so much for joining us, and we hope you have a great day. Feel free to disconnect. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.